बिस्मिल्लाह रहमान रहीम, आई एम डॉक्टर आसिम। टुडे वी विल डिस्कस थायरॉइडाइटिस एंड सम केस सिनेरियो रिगार्डिंग डिफरेंट डिसऑर्डर्स ऑफ थायरॉइड ग्लैंड। थायरॉइडाइटिस इज बेसिकली अ हेटरोजेनस डिजीज विद सेवरल सब टाइप्स एंड दे हैव सम कॉमन फीचर्स। डिफरेंशिएशन ऑफ द सब टाइप्स ऑफ थायरॉइडाइटिस रिक्वायर a proper understanding of their unique clinical presentation, radiological studies, and laboratory data. These diseases include conditions that result in acute illness with severe thyroid pain, like infectious thyroiditis, subacute granulomatous thyroiditis, and disorders in which there is relatively little inflammation and the illness is manifested by the thyroid dysfunction that may be in the form of some disturbance in the thyroid hormone levels. And like subacute lymphocytic thyroiditis and fibrous thyroiditis. Now, how we have to differentiate? If there is neck pain, then we have to think about presence of the neck pain, then we should go for the radioiodine uptake. If it is increased, then some microbial inflammatory thyroiditis is may be present. But if it is decreased, then subacute granulomatous thyroiditis should be suspected. But in the absence of the pain, and the presenting symptoms are there of the hyperthyroidism, then radioiodine uptake will differentiate between Graves' disease and subacute lymphocytic thyroiditis. Mind it, Graves' disease is not the part of the thyroiditis conditions. It is a separate entity, autoimmune disorder. If radioiodine uptake is decreased, then there should be suspicion of subacute lymphocytic thyroiditis. And if there is a picture of the hypothyroidism, then chronic lymphocytic thyroiditis must be considered in mind. Hashimoto's thyroiditis, it is the most common cause of hypothyroidism in areas where is iodine is sufficient. Its name is derived from the 1912 report by Hashimoto's, describing patients with goiter and intense lymphocytic infiltration of thyroid, which was also known as stroma lymphomatosa. There is an autoimmune destruction in the gland. Females are more involved and it is more common in females. The ratio is 10 to 1 up to 20 to 1. There is a painless enlargement of the thyroid gland. Although it is a disease of the older female, but it may occur in some young children also. There is diffuse in this Hashimoto's thyroiditis, there is diffuse dense lymphocytic infiltrate with germinal centers. Residual thyroid follicles are lined by the deeply eosinophilic Hürthen cells are also seen. Morphology, thyroid is often diffusely enlarged, although more localized enlargements may be seen in some cases. The capsule is intact. Cut surface is pale gray, firm, and friable. There is infiltration of the mononuclear cells, small lymphocytes, plasma cells. There are atrophic follicles, and these are lined by the epithelial cells. Microscopic examination reveals extensive infiltration of the parenchyma by the mononuclear inflammatory cells. The presence of the Hürthen or the eosinophil cells in conjunction with the heterogeneous population of lymphocytes, it is characteristic of the thyroiditis. Now see, let's see over this. This is intense and chronic inflammatory cell infiltrate. These are present over here. Follicle may be atrophic. There may be infiltrate and atrophy of the follicle cells. If in fine needle aspiration biopsy specimens, the presence of the Hürthel cell in conjunction with the heterogeneous population lymphocyte is the classic form of the Hashimoto's disease, thyroiditis. But unlike Riddle's thyroiditis, fibrosis does not extend beyond the capsule of the gland. This thing has to be remembered. The fibrosis is limited. Now, if you look at the picture, this is the pathogenesis of Hashimoto's thyroiditis. Breakdown of the peripheral tolerance to thyroid autoantigens results in progressive autoimmune destruction of thyrocytes by infiltrating cytotoxic T cells, locally released cytokines, or by antibody dependent cytotoxicity. Now, there are three pathways in which the CD4 cells and thyrocyte injury is due to this interferon gamma with the activated macrophages. And if CD8 cells are involved, then cytotoxic T cell destruction of the will be leading through T cell mediated cytotoxicity. And then the role of the plasma antibody against the anti-thyroid antibodies and natural killer cells, they are attached to the Fc receptor of the thyroid cells and lead to the antibody dependent cell mediated cytotoxicity. Then there is another condition which is called granulomatous thyroiditis or de Keurwein thyroiditis. Most commonly and in most of the cases, it is post viral disease. A patient having some viral disorder, viral infection, or preferably upper respiratory, then it may predispose to the development of the granulomatous thyroiditis. If we see the, it may have some seasonal incidence. The disorder is more common between the ages of 40 and 50. Affects women considerably more than the men. In this type of the thyroiditis, it is believed that triggered by the viral infection, majority of the patients will be having upper respiratory tract infection. The disease has a seasonal incidence. Thyroid parenchyma contains chronic inflammatory cells and infiltrate with a multinucleate joint cell and colloid follicle. These are the features of the granulomatous thyroiditis. Gland may be unilaterally or bilaterally enlarged and firm with an intact capsule. Histologically, changes are patchy, depend on the stage of the disease also. In the later stages of the disease, a chronic inflammatory infiltrate and fibrosis may replace the foci of the injury. It is silent, subacute lymphocytic thyroiditis, it's a silent or painless thyroiditis. Up to 5% of the women, they may have postpartum thyroiditis. painless, and the postpartum thyroiditis are variants of the Hashimoto's thyroiditis. Since the majority of the patients have circulating anti-thyroid peroxidase antibodies or a family history of other autoimmune thyroid diseases. In this condition, there is no presence of the peripheral cells. Other less common form of the thyroiditis is Riddle thyroiditis, which is a rare disease, and it is characterized by extensive fibrosis involving the thyroid gland and contiguous neck structures. Now we'll discuss some case scenarios of the thyroid disorders. Very simple questions. You'll have to focus on the questions which are in the key points of all the statements. Case one is, 2-year-old child has had failure to thrive. Child is short with coarse facial features, a protruding tongue, and an umbilical hernia. Profound mental retardation is present. As the clinic child mature, the findings are consistent with which of the following conditions? So, very simple question. We have studied in the last lectures that these features are typically of a patient who is 2 years old, umbilical hernia, when you had seen the picture of that one, and coarse facial features, and this is another important point, protruding tongue. It cannot be in the congenital adrenal hyperplasia. It cannot be in the pheochromocytoma. In Hashimoto's thyroiditis, we discussed there are no such features. Diabetes is out of question. So only thing is left is the cretinism. The cretinism is the form of the hypothyroidism in the child. But if it is present in the adult, then it is called myxedema or hypothyroidism of the adult patients. Second case. A 47-year-old woman visits her physician because she noticed a lump in her neck 1 year ago. On physical examination, there is 2-centimeter nodule in the right lobe of the thyroid gland. A fine needle aspiration biopsy is performed, and microscopic examination of the specimen cells consistent with the follicular neoplasm. She undergoes a subtotal thyroidectomy. Which of the following laboratory tests should be performed in this patient in the immediate postoperative period? It's very difficult for a lengthy scenario to be understood in 1 minute, but purpose of giving this scenario, this case, it may be given in some form, but you must know which points to be considered. What he is asked is, which test we should perform in the postoperative period? Case is clearly diagnosed consistent with the follicular neoplasm. Now, what can happen in this case? If you just concentrate on one thing, that if there is an operation, the accidental removal of the or damage to the parathyroid gland during the thyroid surgery can cause hypocalcemia, secondary to hypoparathyroidism. It is the most common cause of the hypoparathyroidism in such type of the cases. The TSH concentration can increase if the patient becomes hypothyroid. The question is that what should be the level which should be performed? Calcitonin will not be helpful, TSH will not be helpful. Immediate postoperative period, if there has been some damage, the level should be measurable, should be the calcium one. Next scenario is very lengthy, but to just try to understand. A 60-year-old woman has a felt a lump on the right side of her neck for several months. This is the point. On physical examination, found 3 centimeter mass in the right lobe of the thyroid gland. No adenopathy. Lab results show serum TSH of 3 million international units, which is normal. T4 level of 8.8 microgram per deciliter. Then she undergoes thyroidectomy. Solid mass is present within the right thyroid lobe. 6 months later, she visits her physician because the pain in the right thigh. A radiograph shows a fracture of the right femur in an area of the lytic bone destruction. A radioiodine scan shows uptake localized to the region of the fracture. Which of the following was most likely to have been present in the patient's thyroid gland? Difficult scenario, but try to understand what he is asking. He is asking which was basically the fault at the time. What it can be. Lump. 6 months later, again usko pain start ho gayi. What it can be. This patient has follicular carcinoma, which can be difficult to differentiate from the follicular adenoma unless there is microscopic evidence of the invasion. Other things, they are not inconsistent with that. So we have to see follicular carcinoma much less likely than papillary carcinoma to involve lymph nodes, but they are more likely to metastasize to distant sites. This point has to be remembered. Thyroiditis is unlikely manifest as a mass because the entire gland typically involved. Medullary carcinoma is less common than the follicular carcinoma. These are the basic some features which you have to remember when you are attempting some scenarios. So in this case, it will be follicular carcinoma. Then another case, there is a 40-year man consults physician because of the weight loss, increased appetite, double VM. On physical examination, temperature is 37, pulse is 106. These 2 points must be kept in mind, increased appetite, double VM. Respiration 15, blood pressure 140/80, fine tremor, which is a characteristic feature of some disease of the thyroid, in the outstretched hand. He has bilateral proptosis. Now, heading towards the clear diagnosis, lab results show TSH level of 0.1. Another key point which is focusing towards some a particular disease. Radioiodine scan indicates increased diffuse uptake throughout the thyroid gland. He receives propylthiouracil and his condition improves. Which of the following best describes the microscopic appearance of the patient's thyroid gland? Now, all the picture has been given and what has been asked? Which picture? Destruction of the follicles, lymphoid aggregates, and Hurthers cell metaplasia. And second is papillary projections in thyroid follicles and lymphoid aggregates, follicular destruction, nodules with the nests of the cells separated by hyaline stroma, and large thyroid follicles lined by the flattened epithelial cell. What was the actual scenario? All things pointing towards one thing which has been treated. What is asked? A totally different question. That is, 40-year double VN, fine tremor, scan, radioiodine scan. The picture must be very much clear of that Graves' disease. Now, what can be the answer? Papillary projections in the thyroid follicles and the lymphoid aggregates in the stroma. When you'll see the diagram in your province, which chapter, you will definitely see the infoldings and the papillary projections in the Graves' disease. The next scenario is last one. 45 years old woman reports a feeling of fullness in her neck but has no other complaints. Feeling of fullness. Enlargement has been gradual and painless for more than 1 year. More than 1 year. It's a quite a lengthy time. Physical examination confirms diffuse enlargement of the thyroid gland without any apparent masses. Lab studies of the thyroid function show a normal pre-T4 level, slightly increased TSH level. What is the most likely cause of the findings? If it could have been Graves' disease, hypothyroidism, some other key point has been given. Here it is, the key point is the painless for more than 1 year. And these are the very obscure findings, but this painless, diffuse enlargement, these are the two points which should highlight towards what? One is toxic multinodular goiter, papillary carcinoma, subacute granulomatous thyroiditis, Hashimoto's thyroiditis, or then diffuse non-toxic goiter. Why it has been not causing the problem to the patient? Because it was non-toxic. Why it is diffuse? Because physical exam confirms a diffuse enlargement of that one. So whenever you are attempting the MCQ, you must keep in mind what type of their statement is. Although it's very difficult to understand the things in 1 minute, but this is the practice you have to do for yourself. You may get a little bit less lengthy scenario, but there it will be more difficulty for you to pick up the things. So these are the few scenarios which we wanted to discuss. You can ask any question on the WhatsApp group, and thank you very much.